in this chapter is privilege. And I look around the room, and I hate to let you all know that almost all of you appear to have basically all of the privilege. So you should feel very ashamed of yourselves. And again, let's talk about the reality. The reality of privilege is someone like myself, a white man, it is, I think, a worthwhile thing for me to recognize that over the course of human history, and even recent history, relatively recent history in the United States, people who look like me have had an extraordinarily privileged existence compared to people who don't look like me. And I think that is something that is worthwhile to keep in mind when I'm exchanging ideas and talking with people and being like, hey, we come from different places. There was a long time in our country where an African-American person or a Latina would not be, you know, not allowed to vote, not allowed to own land, not free to live their own lives even, let alone have this type of exchange. And keeping that in mind, being introspective and self-aware is a healthy thing. There has been privilege. That is a reality. The problem is when you take the term and the concept of privilege and then turn that into a weapon where you say, and because your type has had privilege for so long, we've heard enough from you. And now you cannot, your opinion doesn't matter, it is invalid, we don't want to hear from you. Your turn is over, it's our turn now. That is not healthy. That is not what America should be about. We should recognize that we come from different places, concede the points occasionally and say, maybe I can't understand your experience the way you can, and have a productive conversation. That is different than saying, basically, privilege, shut up. It's a shortcut to shut up. And one example that we give is, I don't know if they do it here at Bucknell, but there's a number of universities that do for freshman week, new student week, they do what's called a privilege walk, where they will take the freshman class and line them up on a football field, basically. And they will say, okay, freshman class, welcome. Let's do a team building experience called privilege walk. So take two steps forward if your parents are still together, and take three steps backward if you're LGBT. Take seven steps forward if you're white, take four steps back if you're black. And over the course of this event, they are sort of literally tearing the class apart to show all these differences where the people at the front of the line are made clearly to feel guilty for all the privilege that they have. And the people at the back are like, ha, see? And it's like right out of the gate, you're setting up this, I think, really unfortunate dynamic where rather than being like, we are all equal and our opinions should be weighed based on the merits and based on the factual basis and how we make them, as opposed to the identity of who we are right out of the gate. I don't think that that is progress. I think that is the opposite of progress. And then one of the elements of this book, and the chapter in particular that is maybe my favorite, is we talk about how there seems to be sort of an asterisk when it comes to privilege, where there are exceptions to be made. And one prominent, very curious exception that we delve into is the exception of a woman by the name of Elizabeth Warren, who is a senator from Massachusetts, a Democrat. And Elizabeth Warren is a white woman, okay? Let's just get that right out there. Statement of fact, white check. And so she went to law school. She became an attorney. She started teaching at sort of some lower tier law schools. And she thought to herself, you know, I'm better than this. I really ought to be teaching in the Ivy League. And so she began checking a box on her professional, her professional resume, that she was a racial minority. And her basis for this was that she was a Native American. So she started checking the box, I'm a minority, I'm a Native American, and lo and behold, she gets hired almost immediately into the Ivy League at the University of Pennsylvania. And then she gets basically promoted over to Harvard. By the way, there are huge diversity controversies at these schools at the time with lots of pressure to step up the diversity, and she is touted in in sort of literature and that sort of thing for the schools, like, you know, we're really stepping up, we're ramping up our minority hiring. So she gets to Harvard, gets tenure at Harvard Law School, which is the peak of that career path, at which point she stops checking the box. She's no longer officially or professionally a Native American because she's gotten where she needed to go. So when she ran for Senate in 2012 against Scott Brown in Massachusetts, this became an issue. Scott Brown raised it, it came up in debates, she was very indignant. She said, how dare you insult my family and all this sort of thing. And they asked her, well, why did you stop checking the box? And she had all sorts of ludicrous stories about that. And finally, the issue came to a head, and she brought out a genealogist that she had dug up from somewhere, who said, I believe that Elizabeth Warren is 1/32nd Cherokee. And then the actual Cherokees rolled in, and they were like, nah, bro, you are 0/32nd Cherokee, in fact, based on our records. So that was a problem for her. So she said, okay, well, hang on, I've got, you know, they say 0/32nd, my person says 1/32nd, who can really say? And the Cherokees were like, we can say, this is what we do. And she said, no, but I've got more explanations, I've got more evidence, and this is the part where I have to give a disclaimer that I am just quoting her. I am not being racist, this is literally what she said. So she said, and she's out of the press, my family's from Oklahoma, and my papa, my grandfather, quote, had high cheekbones like all the Indians do. Actual quote, and like even like the liberal press was like, oh my, like that isn't, like Liz, that's not helpful. And so the Browns were like, oh my God, like the high cheekbones became a whole thing. She's like, all right, fine, forget it. Forget the genealogy, forget the cheekbones. Here we go, more proof. I contributed a recipe to a Native American themed cookbook. I swear to God this is true. The name of the cookbook, I swear, is Pow Wow Chow. That's a real thing. So someone went and found a copy of Pow Wow Chow, which in fact existed, and yes, indeed, Elizabeth Warren had submitted a recipe to Pow Wow Chow, case closed, Native American, until it was quickly alleged and then discovered that it appeared that the recipe had been plagiarized from the New York Times published cookbook. And we're sort of like, how did they ever find out it was plagiarized? Well, perhaps because a central ingredient of the supposed family recipe from Oklahoma was fresh crab meat and like Worcestershire sauce. We're like, you know, perhaps fresh crab meat was not in plentiful supply in the 19th century Oklahoma plain. So like every excuse from the genealogist to the cheekbones to Pow Wow Chow was just bullshit. It just was. And the Washington Post went through, did a whole fact check, and she was wrong. She won anyway, of course, because Massachusetts. But the point of the story is, here's a woman, a very privileged woman, a white woman, Ivy League, tenured law professor, running for the United States Senate, who had spent a decade or more, 2 decades of her adult life, pretending to be a racial minority that she wasn't, or like going on family folklore or something, and basically absconding with someone else's privilege. Like Native Americans were treated really badly in this country. There's a reason why they're a very small minority that get like particularly generous sort of affirmative action type treatment. She went in and swooped in and selectively took it for herself for just the amount of time that she needed to get to where she needed to go professionally and then drop them like a bad habit. And this was completely fine with the left. They love her, she's a giant hero. Elizabeth Warren, she should have run for president, she should be president, blah, blah, blah.